Good morning, year 8. This is a lesson from Miss Lawson for 8A1 and 8B4. I hope you've had a lovely week and you're all keeping up to date with the work as well as you can. I think things are settled and calmed down a little bit. I'm hopeful that the ones that I've spoken to this week, you seem a little bit more on top of things. I'm going to get into that habit and that routine of starting a new lesson every Monday. Even if you don't access this lesson on Mondays, at least you know what is expected of you that coming week. Well done to those of you that have sent me your worksheets and your tasks. Brilliant, really well done. Some of you are still struggling to access Microsoft Teams and wondering how you would upload it, and I'm going to go through that at the end of this lesson. And also, I've been looking at Seneca, so this week's task, homework task, beside what is included in this lesson, will be Seneca tasks, and I've got some praise to give out to so many of you who have kept up with those tasks on there as well. So really well done. Right, just as we would normally do, please, we have a do now task. Let's have a look at the significance of the window, and I'm not talking necessarily just the window that's in the book, you know, where Bruno is obviously, he's seeing something outside the window, he goes to show his sister, and they both stare at it quite a fair time and discuss what's beyond the window. But I'm talking about in general window. How do you and what do you associate with a window? What do they allow us to do? Do they provide protection, and from what? And what do you think the window in the book represents? This is just a way of you getting your little minds whirring and whizzing through, just as you always do. You can write little notes, you can make a mind map, you can write full sentences however you wish. Just write some adjectives even, just to see if you can try to link the window and what it's trying to represent within the book. At the end of this lesson, you are going to have understood the use of new literary devices. And some of you are going to be aware of some of these devices already. That's brilliant. That's just going to be a recap information for you. There is a new one that I don't think anyone's going to have had. I can think of a couple of students that I know that are going to be absolutely delighted with this, with these new devices. So if you're smiling, you know who I'm talking about. And then we're going to use the clues from the text just to develop an overall picture of what's going on, the setting of the book, but also how the camp's laid out, where the house is and so on. So you can get more of a tangible feel for the book and what's going on. Okay. So the significance of the window. Hopefully you've paused the video just to do that 5-minute task, because I am going to go into a bit more in depth now, so you can add to those notes with what my interpretation of the window is to represent. It's a symbol of something, okay? So you may or may not agree, we will see. Okay, so the significance of the window within the book is it's a form of symbolism, okay? So John Boyne is using the window to access and gain information, and it's a symbol really. So a window in general creates boundaries, okay? So if you stare out, stop listening, or maybe carry on listening to me, but look out the window where you can see, perhaps you can see a house or a car, you can see someone getting into a car. You can't actually physically touch what you're looking at, okay? There's something in the way, it's preventing you. You can't move right or left. You can't access or touch what I've just said. So if you think about a zoo, for instance, you go to a zoo and you might see a massive boa constrictor behind some glass. You can't touch it, thank goodness, and it can't touch you. So if you see someone getting into the car and they've got their shopping bags with them, you can only assume that they're going to Tesco's. They may well not be. They may be going to see a friend, for instance. Let's hope they're not under lockdown. So your mind can only be taken as far as your eye can see, which is really important if you think about it. You're gazing life on the outside, and lots of us are doing that more and more during lockdown. We can't access life, okay? Windows, it's like a TV screen. We're watching life go on and unfold beyond us, what we can see, okay? Window is a portal. It shows you sites that you didn't know existed before. Perhaps you didn't know that man lived there. Perhaps you didn't know that man had a dog. And it triggers thoughts and feelings about beyond what you're actually looking at. So that house is just a house. It's a rectangle. It's brick. It has a roof, but then your mind can be taken elsewhere. Who lives in that house? What's it decorated inside like? Who lives there, for instance? Your mind is then leading on through the window. And what is just essentially a pane of glass, in a, often a rectangle shape, can just show you so much. There's a whole world outside. However, So not really for what we call proactive people, so people that are taking part in life, because you're stuck behind the glass. You're only watching on the periphery of the outside. So you can't, you can't access life. You can't go and get into that man's car, for instance. You can't go and talk to him. You're watching from behind, which gives you quite a narrow point of view. Okay, you can't actually go and talk to him. You're not going to learn anything more than what you can only see. Human beings are also really drawn to bright, warm lights that shade, you know, comes through the window. Perhaps you didn't quite close your curtains properly at night time and the light starts streaming through in the morning, which is usually quite a positive thing as a human being. However, John Boyne has shown that the children and the reader, that there are sometimes things outside the window we might not want to see. It's not always a happy one. You can have a pause of these videos, have a read through my points. It is what John Boyd is trying to do, but you might not always agree with what my interpretation is, and you may also be able to add things. Okay, so one of those things there is the window's protecting and preventing you from people harming you, or perhaps the wind and the rain, or strangers such as strangers such as burglars, for instance, is protecting you. So the windows can be a good thing, but also I think they can be quite a negative thing. You only get one point of view on things. You can only see out of the window and watch as life goes by. Right, once you've added those around your window, maybe you've drawn a window, which would be fantastic. If you want to send me pictures of that on Microsoft Teams, that'd be amazing. If we have a look at page 24 in the first few chapters, obviously this lesson is based on the first four chapters that you should have read. If you haven't read that, pause this video now and go and catch up, because this lesson is only going to be applicable if you read those first four chapters. Gretel calls a new home out with. Okay, so some of you are going to obviously understand that what she's trying to say is a mispronunciation for Auschwitz, okay, which was the largest German Nazi concentration camp. We looked at that in our Do Now task, the image that you had to annotate and analyse. It was where 1.1 million people died, men, women and children. The awful atrocities that went on in these concentration camps, but Auschwitz is probably one of the most famous ones. However, because we know what Gretel was trying to say, how does it make us feel towards Gretel and Bruno? I mean, how does it make us feel for them as people? They're very, very young. They're only 9 and 12. Obviously, Gretel is the elder one, and you can tell that she's the elder one. But still, they're still ultimately just children, and they're really quite naive. Okay, so how does it make us, the reader, feel? She has no idea what the real camp is all about. She has no idea that Auschwitz actually is Auschwitz. So just stop this video for a second. Spend 5 minutes thinking about how this makes the reader feel towards the characters of Bruno and Gretel. Maybe to come up with three adjectives based on perhaps being naive. Okay. We could also do this together. So if we pop if you want to do little stick people, would help if I had your hand back. You could do little stick people, draw the characters, and you could put these three as their kind of character traits of who they are at the moment, because they have no idea, despite their father being this very prominent person who's linked to this camp and what's going on in there. They are kept very, very innocent from the atrocities and the horror that's going beyond those barbed wire. So naive, innocent, are the words that we could think about. How about unenlightened? That'd be a good one. So unenlightened, that's partly to do with the fact that they are young. It's partly to do with the fact that children tend to just be quite innocent to what's going on around them. They're often shielded by their parents, and so the reader is then got more empathy and more sympathy for these children. They've been uprooted from their house in Berlin, they've lost their friends, but now also they have no idea, they can't possibly conceive what they're viewing out of that window. In terms of looking at the words out with, you could have the connotations and the links of forget the Auschwitz part of it. You could actually say the out with minorities of Germany, such as the Jews. It could be a way of getting out the people that they didn't want in within their society, the Nazis didn't want in their society. You could say it's on the outside, like a preposition, like, a, you know, away from the atrocities, they've got this house. And the house, although, isn't particularly great. It is a much safer place than the camp. John Boyne has used the word hollow. So hollow gives us the connotations and the feelings of something that's void. It's empty. Maybe as empty and void of love or light or happiness, and it might collapse around their ears, which gives us the whole idea of fragility. It's going to break at any moment, which could be then imagery for actually what is going to happen. It's like a sense of forewarning about what is going to happen later on in the book. Right, we're not going to do that, Smart. What we are going to do is have a look at a section of what you should have read by now. And I'm just going to go over these new terms for you now. And we're just going to really pick apart these together. So pop your pens down and let's just read through this together. He sat down on the bed and for a moment wished that Gretel would sit down beside him and put her arm around him and tell him that it was all going to be all right and that sooner or later they'd get to like it here and they'd never want to go back to Berlin. So like I just said, I've highlighted the fact that Gretel was 12, she's older, but she's still a child. But because he's 9, he's really looking for guidance and sympathy and comfort. His mum is obviously not particularly happy with the situation. She doesn't feel like she's had much of a choice. And obviously he's not going to get reassurance from his father. His father's very busy. He's commented on the fact that the father is quite serious and quite strict anyway, so they're not going to have that relationship, so he's going to obviously look for it somewhere else. Right, but she was still watching from the window, and this time she wasn't looking at the flowers or the pavement or the bench with the plaque on it or the tall fence or the wooden telegraph poles or the barbed wire bells or the hard ground beyond them or the huts or the small buildings or the smokestacks. Instead she was looking at the people. That is a really beautiful paragraph, because what we get in the sense of is that all of these things, all the actual hardened physicalities, the actual tangible things that you can see and touch, the pavement, the bench, the tall fence, the wooden telegraph pole, the barbed wire, they mean very little, because all she can see is the people. It's that human element of what's going on. The first things that they did notice, and I'm going to go over that in a second, were obviously the physical things, but now she's focused on the people. Also, this is your very first term, and you're going to maybe some of you have heard it, I doubt it. It is a form of polysyndeton. Polysyndeton is a device that often is used in writing. So if you want to write the definition down, you can, or you can just stop and listen to me a second. It's a device where instead of having the commas, you'd have a conjunction. So something in this instance, it would be or. Okay. So for example, he ran and jumped and laughed for joy. So that is got the conjunction of and. Or Miss Lawson felt all she did was clean and cook and mark and write essays and hoover and moan, and she really needed a holiday in the sun. Okay, so we've got the conjunction and. It's a form of forming those sentences. We've talked in depth about short sentences and long sentences in class. Okay, so this is a form of way of making a really long sentence. Instead of putting those commas here, which we would normally do, and I'd be like, why have you not used your punctuation? What they've done is they've taken the commas out, or the Boyne in this extract here, he's put the word or, I'm going to put and. And it's just a way of changing the rhythm of something. It just flows a bit longer. If we read this again, but she was still watching from the window, and this time she wasn't looking at the flowers or the pavement or the bench with the plaque on it, or the tall fence, or the wooden telegraph poles, or the barbed wire, or the hard ground, or the huts, or the small buildings, or. So we've got lots and lots of repetition of the conjunction or here, okay? Which changes the rhythm, it changes the structure, but often it can then connote a kind of different emotion. It shows us a different feeling, often sadness or happiness. I don't know what kind of overall impression you're going to get from my little rant there, but often it can be used with children, because children tend to say, I would like an ice cream and a hot chocolate and some chips and some trip to the park, and you get that kind of childlike exuberance, you know, that happiness. So it's often in a childlike way. So in this example, I personally think it's a link to their childhood. They are children, but obviously also it's trying to disregard all of those parts, that all those physical things that she can see, and she's just focusing on the people. It's highlighting that actually these things don't matter, but the people do. So write Polly Sinderton Town. You've got years and years and years to come and practice that. So don't panic if you don't understand it. But it is a really lovely word. There's a couple of students in 8A1 that you'll know you're going to want to know the etymology of the word. Please go and Google it. But if I give you the hint that Polly means several or more than one, you think about other words that have got the word Polly in it. And then Sinderton, well, I'm going to let you Google it, and I would like you to see if you can send it to me. Right, and also within this chapter, there's this really quite interesting couple of paragraphs. This is the shortened version. Let's read it together, and you're going to be showing another device, which I think some of you are already going to know. Past the flowers, there was a very pleasant pavement with a wooden bench on it, where Gretel could imagine sitting in the sunshine and reading a book. There was a plaque attached to the top of the bench, but she couldn't read the inscription from this distance. The seat was turned to face the house, which, usually, would be a strange thing to do, but on this occasion, she could understand why. About 20 feet further along from the garden and the flowers and the bench with the plaque on it, everything changed. Okay, so that is the first part. And then it literally links on to this next paragraph. There was a huge wire fence that ran along the length of the house and turned in at the top, extending further along in either direction, further than she could possibly see. The fence was very high, higher even than the house they were standing in, and there were huge wooden posts, like telegraph poles, dotted along it, holding it up. At the top of the fence, enormous bales of barbed wire were tangled in spirals. There wasn't any grass after the fence. In fact, there was no greenery anywhere to be seen in the distance. Instead, the ground was made up of a sand-like substance, and as far as she could make out, there was nothing but low huts and large square buildings dotted around, and one or two smokestacks in the distance. So what we've got here is a description of what she's seeing out through the window. Remember that whole symbol of the window, of not being able to access what's going on outside, not being able to touch it, being prevented by this glass. Okay, so she's looking outside the window with her brother. And if you look at this left-hand side, she was actually quite pleased with what she first saw. Okay, if you can look at the word, maybe we could look at the semantic field of these two different paragraphs. We've got the pleasant pavement. Pavement sounds quite nice, with a lovely, cute little wooden bench on it. And she can imagine sitting in the sunshine reading a book, which all sounds rather dreamlike, doesn't it? There was a plaque attached to the top of the bench, but she couldn't read the inscription. But the seat was turned to face the house, which would usually be a strange thing to do, but on this occasion she could understand why, because she's saying she doesn't want to look away from the house. So the bench is purposely facing the lovelier house. I mean, we still know that it's not the best house, it's not like their Berlin house. With here a garden and flowers, and then just 20 feet, everything changed. There's a huge wire fence. It says that the fence was very high, higher than the house. There was these awful telegraph-type poles dotted along fence, enormous bales of barbed wire. So that's the wire with the sharp, sharp parts onto the wire. They're tangled in spirals, and there wasn't any grass. So this is complete opposite to the flowers and the bench and the pleasant pavement and the garden that she's viewing outside of Bruno's window. In fact, the ground was made of a sand-like substance, which gives us the impression of something dry and arid. And as far as she could make out, there was nothing but low huts and large square buildings dotted. And then, awfully right at the end, two smokestacks in the distance, which we will come to further on in the book. If you think about the complete opposites of these two paragraphs, which are directly together, okay, we're going to come across the term juxtaposition. Most of you will have known that already, but even if you haven't, just to try and write it down. So juxtaposition is, I'm going to show you the example, is an act or an instance of placing two elements close together side by side. So if you think it's only 20 feet, she says here, it's only 20 feet further along from the garden and the flowers and the bench. Was this awful scene, the dry, arid depravity of what's going on with those poor people. So the writer has done that deliberately, and there is a reason for that. So the John Boyne has used juxtaposition. It's sort of trying to compare and contrast the two to show the similarities and the differences. So similarities, well, they're on the same part of the land, they're only 20 feet away. But obviously there's the people in it. The fact that Bruno is a male young man. He's 9, he's looking at these other males that are behind this fence. They're all human, and actually John Boyne is trying to show the contrast between the two. So that's juxtaposition. If you want to stop this video, pause, write the title, write the word juxtaposition. If you have a look at these images, they're my own personal images. As you well know, I do like taking photographs of the streets of one of our most affluent cities, which is Cambridge. We see so much affluence and wealth, and this picture here, we've got a bank worth billions and billions of pounds, and then we have someone homeless sleeping outside of the bank. So if you think this person here, he has literally nothing apart from just a book and a small bag of his own belongings, but he's sat outside a billion pound corporation. So that's a juxtaposition between the two. And again, we hear on the left-hand side a slightly more tenuous version of juxtaposition, but we've got an empty shop that's to let, it's empty, it's not being used, and then we have this man who's homeless. So if you look at the contrast of how John Boyne has deliberately put those two paragraphs together, hopefully that and those pictures you'll be able to understand what juxtaposition is, and if you do know, then you're just going to have that recapped. Because that will bring you onto your extended writing task. So besides your Seneca learning, which will be 30 minutes long, you are also going to do an extended writing task for me, please. It's quite a simple question. It's explain how John Boyne has used juxtaposition to influence readers. But we're not going to talk about polysyndeton. We're not going to talk about imagery necessarily. I just want you to talk about, symbolism of the window. I want us to talk about juxtaposition. How does it influence and affect us as readers? Okay, so here's some tips and bullet points. You might need to pause this and just have a look at this as you're writing it. Juxtaposition can intrigue the readers, making them want to read further. So the way that her eyes are then following down, talking about the things that she can see, our eyes are then taken on a journey, our mind's eye is taken on a journey to see what's beyond that barbed wire. It creates suspense. It can highlight the contrast between the two different scenes or entities. This highlights the severe situation of the camp and yet the relative safety of the house. So the house, yes, it's hollow and it's empty and it's void of any happiness, but it's safe, okay? Also, we are led to believe so far. And then there is a link between the boys in the camp, like I said, and Bruno, and yet they're in vastly different circumstances. Well, you can see the fact there's probably children, or we know there's children of his age, but the other side of the fence. So I would like you to write me a paragraph, minimum of one paragraph, with that title. Put the title at the top of your page, put the date for me, and actually make sure it's underlined so that when you are sending me your work, hope your Microsoft Teams, you can answer that question for me, please. Use these bullet points. Everything that I've explained in this video will help you answer that question. And then as your final task, beside Seneca, is just to get pen and paper, any plain piece of paper if you can. You can just try to use anything you can. I know not everyone's going to have all the things that they need at home. That's fine, just try to do your best. But I'd like you to try to do a bird's eye view of the house. If you imagine bird's eye, you're looking down. Sometimes if you want to put onto your laptop or Google, on your phone, sorry, Google Maps, you get really different views, like the satellite views and so on, and the terrain views. So that's what you're going to try and aim for. And using the knowledge that you've learned from the first four chapters, actually let's do the first six chapters because you've got a little bit of reading to do this week. Try to see if you can gauge whereabouts on this map that the things are located within each other. We know, for instance, 20 foot from the house, from that window, from the garden with the flowers, we've got the starts of the barbed wire. Try to see if you can pick apart and reacquaint yourself with what you've already red and see if you can make yourself a little map as if you were a bird flying above. The quality of your drawing isn't important. If you just do squares, I don't mind. But it's just a way for you to imagine yourself there, a little bit more of a tangible, you can touch it almost in your mind's eye. So that's probably going to take you probably 5-10 minutes, not too long. Your writing task is going to take you approximately 20-25 minutes. I would like a decent paragraph, please, people. I would like you to give me quotes from that paragraph as well, as per usual. And then in terms of your Seneca Learning, I have set Seneca Learning. Like I said, it's only going to take 30 minutes. In terms of the first week of Seneca Learning, I would just like to say thank you to so many of you. I'm so extremely proud of every single one of you who have accessed Seneca. I think I'm only missing 3 or 4 out of 60 odd students. So I'm so proud of you. With specific praise to these people here, we've got the 2 different classes. You can see if you can spot your name, your initials on here. Really well done. Those are people that have done at least the 5 parts of the Seneca Learning, but they've also done more, or they've got 100%, or they've come close to 100% success rate on those questions. So really well done. And as for extension lesson, if that is not enough for you, because obviously I held a fantastic, well, it wasn't fantastic, it was okay, we're going to practice at it. it was lovely to hear your voices. I held a little tiny conversation discussion over on Microsoft Teams with 8A1. A couple of you turned up and we had a nice chat, and some of you are looking for extra work, which is amazing. So there's going to be a new video coming out later this week. It's not going to be put on Go for Schools. I'm going to put it on Microsoft Teams for you to access if you so choose. I don't want to put it on Go for Schools and bombard you with more work, but it's going to be poetry based. I'm going to be looking at language and techniques of the poem that's linked to concentration camps. So it is going to be part of the same theme. It just gets us practicing that language analysis. And sometimes we do like looking at poetry. And even if you don't want to do it, you can at least just watch it and hear my voice. It's not compulsory. Please make sure you're up to date with the rest of your work first and foremost, and then only do it as an extension task if you so choose. But I am handing out R points, so well done to all of you that have got R points this week. I'm so proud of every single one of you. Like I keep saying, I'm going to stop wittering on now. Rewind this video and start all over again if you need to. And I hope that everyone's keeping safe and staying well and enjoying the book. And I will speak to you soon. Okay, bye.